Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. If a member wishes to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. And at question number one, I call Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it is assessing feedback to the Building a New Scotland series of papers.
And I call Minister Jamie Hepburn, who is joining us remotely. Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I first apologise to me and other members for not being able to be there in person today. We are assessing feedback through a variety of measures, including roundtable events with relevant stakeholders and ministers, following paper launches and other ministerial and official level stakeholder engagement.
Marie McNair.
The recent Building a New Scotland paper, which sets out the Scottish Government's proposals for a humane and principled migration policy after independence. Under former Prime Minister David Cameron, the UK's hostile environment policies came into effect. And this week he's back into Cabinet, unelected and unaccountable. Does the Minister agree with me that the sooner Scotland can introduce our own migration policy that treats migrants with respect, the better?
Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that, and I also welcome the fact that Parliament voted just yesterday in favour of that proposition. Despite the welcome withdrawal of Suella Braverman from government, I can't say that the return of David Cameron or her replacement as James Cleverly fills me with much optimism for the UK government changing tact. Hopefully they will reflect on today's Supreme Court judgment in respect of their Rwanda policy, which has already cost the taxpayer some £140 million in payments to the Rwandan government, and adjust accordingly. But I hold out little hope, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the only with independence can we create a sensible and humane immigration system.
Question number two, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the total cost of its Building a New Scotland series of papers, including the recently published Migration to Scotland After Independence paper.
Minister Jamie Hepburn.
Can I reiterate my apology to Murdo Fraser for not being there in person to answer his question? Then also, the Scottish Government is publishing the publication costs of all the papers in the Building a New Scotland series. The Parliament has been informed of course, for the first five papers in the series, and we'll be publishing the cost and information for the recent Migration to Scotland After Independence paper shortly.
Murdo Fraser.
Thank you to the Minister for his response, although I didn't actually hear a number in the response that he gave. Now, the Constitution, of course, is a reserved matter. The Scottish Government is spending public money on these papers, but we know that people in Scotland don't want independence. We know that even people in the SNP don't think independence is likely to happen. We've got a budget process coming up. We have huge demands on the Scottish Government budget, not least people who have recently been flooded out of their homes looking in vain for support from this Scottish Government. Wouldn't the money be better spent on them than on these pointless papers?
Minister.
Well, can I first of all welcome Mr Fraser's ongoing interest in the Building a New Scotland series. He complains about giving over of parliamentary time to discussing such things. Clearly warming to the prospect and asking me this particular question. In respect of the costs of the work we're undertaking, just to give it some context, Presiding Officer, in 22-23, the Constitutional Futures Division and the Bans papers that were published, the expenditure constituted 0.0035% of the Scottish Government budget. When you compare that with the massive opportunities of independence looking at countries all around us, like Ireland, Norway, Denmark, and Finland, they're all healthier, happier, fairer, and wealthier countries, I think that's a price worth paying.
I've received two requests for supplementaries from members, so I shall take both. Supplementary from Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The values of humanity and compassion to those fleeing persecution and conflict should be central to our approach to migration and asylum policy. Can the Minister say any more about how the UK Government approach, as typified by the Rwanda scheme, which has today been ruled illegal, compares with the Scottish Government approach to asylum and refugee policy, as set out in its recent paper, Migration to Scotland After Independence?
Minister.
Well, I think the UK Government approach speaks for itself. They have overtly said they want a hostile approach to migration, which runs totally counter to to what we require here in Scotland. We need people to come here to Scotland. And what we've laid out in our paper is a sensible and proportionate approach in terms of encouraging people here for the economic opportunities that we have to help support our economy, but also to make sure we have a humane process for supporting people fleeing from torture, from war, from other challenges in other parts of the world. So we've got it right. UK government's got it wrong.
A supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Given the catastrophic effects of Westminster policies have had on Scotland's economy, particularly Trustonomics, which Murdo Fraser was demanding the SNP government follow, can Scotland, first of all, not actually afford not to be talking about independence? But more importantly, can the Scottish Government tell the Chamber what the cost of funding the Scotland office is, and what does that actually deliver for the people of Scotland?
Minister.
Well, let me first of all agree with Mr. Fairley's premise that a good question should be, can Scotland afford not to be independent if we take Brexit? For example, we know that OBR say that that's going to shrink the UK's gross domestic product by some 4% in the longer term. We don't want to be dragged down in that respect. If we talk about the Scotland office, I can't provide the full figures, of course, only the UK government could do that. But we do know that in 22-23, they spent £1.1 million on communications staff alone. They spent £47,370 in travel and subsistence costs in that same year for just four special advisers. That was £19,034 more than 2 years just before. Hardly good value for the taxpayer.
Question number three has been withdrawn. Question number four, Russell Finlay.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the Scottish Census 2022.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. National Records of Scotland published the first results from Scotland's Census 2022 on the 14th of September. The publication represented a historic moment for Scotland, with the largest population ever recorded by Scotland's census of 5.4 million. That's an increase of 2.7% since the previous census in 2011. Following September's publication, the NRS will publish further results from Scotland's census from spring 2024 onwards, and in the summer of 2024, a series of topic data reports will provide new and unique insights into the characteristics of Scotland's people, including information on ethnicity, on religion, the labour market, education and housing, and for the first time will also include data on the armed forces veterans, sexual orientation and trans status or history.
Russell Finlay.
Thank you for that answer. The SNP completely botched Scotland's census and did so because of their ideological obsession with diverging from the rest of the UK. It will therefore be more difficult to plan for the delivery of public services. And National Records of Scotland say that lessons will be learned from this fiasco. Surely there's one main lesson to learn, and that is in 2031, the census should be UK-wide. So will it be, and that's a yes or a no. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the NRS is keen to reflect lessons learned, including how the results now being published are received by users. It's committed to set these out upon conclusion of the 2022 census programme in an evaluation report laid before Parliament by the end of 2024. But I'm sure Mr. Finlay will be delighted to learn that the Office of Statistics Regulation has awarded Scotland's census output with national statistics designation based on the quality, good practice and comprehensiveness of the statistics. Achieving national statistics designation means the expert independent UK regulator has confidence in the statistics that NRS have produced and that Scotland's census forms an integral part of the statistical system in the United Kingdom.
Question number five, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on what plans it has to restore a reported £6.6 million reduction in funding to Creative Scotland in 2024-25.
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government values the importance of the arts, especially their significant contribution to well-being and to the cultural, social and economic life in communities across Scotland. And it's for those reasons, amongst many, that over the last 5 years, the Scottish Government has provided over £33 million to Creative Scotland to compensate for a shortfall in national lottery funding. As a result of rising costs and pressures on budgets across government, the Scottish Government is unable to make up the £6.6 million in national lottery shortfall shortfall funding this financial year. So, subject to the usual parliamentary processes, we will provide this shortfall funding of £6.6 million to Creative Scotland in 24-25, and we hope to be able to provide a further update on funding following publication of the draft budget in December.
Rachel Hamilton.
Presiding Officer, I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his answer. And we all want extra funding for culture, but it will allow great events like the Borders Book Festival in my own constituency to continue to thrive in the future. But the delivery of this funding has been a fiasco. First, the SNP cut the Creative Scotland budget, then announced to great fanfare it was reversing that cut, then restored the cut, then restored the funding again. The SNP U-turned on a U-turn on a U-turn. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that the culture sector needs more certainty than this confusing hokey-cokey?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think it's important to appreciate the context of the end-year finances, because unfortunately Rachel Finlay is not on the culture committee, where she would have heard, Hamilton, might forgive me. I don't know if that's a promotion or a demotion. I'll leave others to decide. In terms of end-year finances, quite important to understand that we had pressures from the UCI Cycling World Championship amounting to £8 million, £6.6 million for Creative Scotland, and a very significant list of cultural projects right across Scotland that were under threat unless we were able to manage the end-of-year finances differently. We have done that in terms of the government taking the UCI Cycling World Championship costs out of the portfolio, and in ensuring that Creative Scotland uses its reserves so there is no detriment to regularly funded organisations. And if I have an opportunity, perhaps later
Thank
in
you,
questions,
Cabinet
I'll
Secretary.
Be able to confirm
Thank
the spending
Thank
that we've
you,
been
Cabinet
able
Secretary,
to go
you're
forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We need to move on to question number six, Stephanie Callaghan.
To ask the Scottish Government regarding its humanitarian aid funding, whether it will provide an update on any further action it can take to help provide support to those affected by the conflict in Gaza.
Cabinet Secretary.
We unequivocally condemn the abhorrent terrorist attacks committed by Hamas. However, in exercising its right to defend itself, Israel must abide by international humanitarian law, and the civilian populations in both Gaza and the West Bank cannot and must not be held responsible for crimes committed by a terrorist organisation. Last week, we announced a further £250,000 contribution towards the UN's flash appeal in response to the humanitarian crisis in Gaza, in addition to the £500,000 we committed last month.
Stephanie Callaghan.
Scotland will always be a welcoming place and compassionate sanctuary for refugees. Given the harrowing and inhumane conditions that we're witnessing in Gaza and the immediate and growing need for support, particularly when the UK government's stance on an immediate ceasefire is conflicting, can the Minister provide an update on what further steps the Scottish Government can take to welcoming Palestinian refugees in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the First Minister has been clear that we stand ready to welcome refugees in Scotland should that be required. And the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice wrote already to the former Home Secretary requesting a meeting to discuss plans. And I also reiterated these calls in my recent appearances before the Constitution, Europe and External Affairs and Culture Committee. So we await to hear from the new Home Secretary what approach he plans to take.
And supplementary, Carol Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is estimated that 50,000 pregnant women are trapped in Gaza, around 5,000 due to give birth in the next month. Without clean water, medicine and humanitarian aid, these women and their babies will be at risk, which is devastating. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary what discussions have been had with relevant aid organisations regarding the specific challenges facing pregnant women, and if in future discussions regarding humanitarian aid, he will raise the specific needs of this key vulnerable group whenever he has the opportunity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I agree entirely with the question that's been raised. Our main interlocutors in relation to aid in Gaza are with the United Nations Relief and Works Agency, who are the UN agency that deal with the Palestinian authorities. We, of course, believe that a ceasefire is absolutely key to being able to ensure that the humanitarian support manages to get in and to deal with the very specific challenges that there are that the member has raised, but many others, because unfortunately the civilian population are suffering grievously in Gaza, and everything needs to be done to help and support them, whilst, of course, acknowledging, as I have already, our condemnation, no doubt across the chamber, in marking our opposition to the terrorist atrocity that Hamas visited on innocent Israeli people in October.
Question number 7, Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its commitment to increase funding for the arts and culture sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm pleased today to report that the Scottish Government has released £6.68 million of funding to the culture sector for the rest of this financial year. This funding will benefit individuals and communities across Scotland through our support to programmes like Culture Collective, and demonstrates our continued investment in screen and festivals. In spite of the incredibly challenging picture, we've prioritised our investment in culture to support the sector, acknowledging its vital contribution to our economy and to ensure everyone has the opportunity to experience the transformative and empowering potential of culture.
Co-Cab Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. He will be aware several important projects require capital funding in the Glasgow area, many of which are strategically important to the economic development of the city. Glasgow Life has called for a funding model that outlines how the Scottish Government will support cultural provision in Scotland while addressing discrepancies between cities and regions. Can the Minister assure my constituents the possibility of direct central government funding to Glasgow's national assets will be taken into serious consideration with his department's increased budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, first of all, dealing with this year, in terms of the £6.68 million funding released to the culture sector that I've just announced, the details of those comprise £1.5 million to the Culture Collective Programme, £2 million to Screen Scotland, £250,000 to the Platform for Creative Excellence, £130,000 to the National Performing Companies Touring Fund, and £2.8 million to fund public sector pay policy uplifts. In terms of spending decisions for next year, the kind of issues that Co-Cab Stewart has raised no doubt will be considered, and I can encourage members on all sides of the Chamber who have particular views on how the Scottish Government should invest the increase that we have committed to make for culture. I'd be very grateful to hear those.
And supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over a month ago, the Scottish Government promised Creative Scotland that they would not be left out of pocket by the reinstatement of a 10% cut in core funding. They are desperate looking for assurances, and rightly so, as thousands of jobs are on the line. So, Cabinet Secretary, will you guarantee today that your funding commitments to Creative Scotland will be met?
I'm happy to repeat that again, yes, but I'm sure the member will appreciate in the announcement that I've just made, he would appreciate that in providing those resources to the Culture Collective programme, that is via Creative Scotland. £2 million to Screen Scotland is via Creative Scotland, and £250,000 to the Platform for Creative Excellence is also via Creative Scotland. So not only are we doing that, but we have given a commitment in terms of the £6.6 million that they're using from their reserves now to be reimbursed next year, and I'm happy to repeat that now.
And question number 8, Rhoda Grant.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it will provide to the creative industries in the Highlands and Islands region.
Cabinet Secretary.
So the creative industries make an important contribution societally, culturally and economically to Scotland, and we are proud to support a range of creative organisations in the Highlands and Islands. For example, through our Culture Collective programme, which I just made mention of, where we're supporting the Creative Islands Network, providing opportunities for creative practitioners in the region, and via our regular funding to Creative Scotland, we support organisations including Atlas Arts on Sky and the Highland Print Studio in Inverness.
Rhoda Grant.
The Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the First Minister pledged £100 million extra funding for Creative Scotland over the next 5 years. Summer festivals in my region, such as Belladrum Tartan Heart Festival, Heb Celt, Tunes by the Dunes, Under Canvas by Eden Court, and indeed many others, bring millions of pounds to the area. However, the costs associated with running these events are rising. Can the Cabinet Secretary provide a timetable as to when this money will become available and whether some of the funding will support smaller or new events that can't make multi-year funding applications to Creative Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the point that's just made is extremely important because the funding of different cultural organisations and events takes place in different ways, some through Creative Scotland, others directly. And so we need to make sure that we're reaching the entirety of Scotland's cultural and arts landscape. So the point she makes is a very good one. And I would encourage her, as I've already said earlier, I would encourage her and other members who have very particular regional, local or sectoral areas of concern about funding to please make sure that they are sent on to me. We are going through the standard budgetary procedure at the present time. We are in a positive situation in terms of culture and the arts because we have secured a commitment from the Scottish Government. Yes, I'm aware of it because I made the suggestion. And so I am very keen to make sure that it delivers the kind of changes that I'm sure we all want to see, the thriving of the culture and arts sector, the length of the breadth of Scotland, including, of course, the Highlands and Islands of Scotland.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And there will be a very brief pause before we move on to the next portfolio to allow front bench teams to change positions should they wish. Thank you. Thank you. So the next portfolio is Justice and Home Affairs. And again, if any member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press their request to speak button or enter the letters RTS in the chat function during the relevant question. And I call question number one, Annie Wells.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether it has any plans to introduce whole life orders in light of the UK Government's announcement that it will expand their use in England and Wales.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the punishment part of a life sentence is the period that must be served in custody, and High Court judges set this part when imposing a life sentence. Under long-standing law dating back to 2001, judges already have the power to set a punishment part that exceeds the remainder of a prisoner's natural life, which can result in a whole life sentence. The power lies with independent courts to decide when to use their powers, and the Scottish Government supports the courts having those powers.
Annie Wells.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that answer. But Scotland has seen its share of horrific murders in recent years, including the appalling case of Jill Barclay, who was killed in absolutely horrific circumstances. And under the new UK government plans, it is likely that had this murder been committed down south, the perpetrator would be receiving a whole life order, never walking free. However, Scotland's judges don't have the same power as the UK government are planning on doing. So, Cabinet Secretary, my question is simple. Will you give judges the power to lock up criminals for good, with no chance of parole, in sadistic and depraved murder cases?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, as I hoped to have explained to the member in my original answer, our judges, because our law allows it, do have the powers to effectively impose a whole life order on any person convicted of murder. And one example of that would be Angus Sinclair, who received a 37-year punishment part when he was convicted of the World Ends murder when he himself was 69 years old. It is important that it's our judges that make these decisions, and our law enables them to have the fullest range of decision-making. And it's also important to acknowledge, Presiding Officer, that the homicide rate in Scotland has reduced, but I appreciate that one life lost to murder is one too many, and that's for sure.
Question number two, Pam Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the impact of police station closures on police response times.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Police Scotland's approach to responding to incidents is clearly working, with recorded crime being at one of the lowest levels since 1974. When assessing how to respond to an incident, Police Scotland always assesses a reported crime under their Thrive model, which considers threat, harm, risk, investigation, vulnerability and engagement. This places the needs of the individual at the centre of their decisions while ensuring that effective prioritisation is in place. Police Scotland's estate strategy is working to deliver modern and fit-for-purpose police buildings that are co-located with partners and which meet the needs of 21st century operational policing.
Pam Gosling.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Police Scotland has warned they could be forced to shed 2,000 jobs and close 30 police stations thanks to the SNP funding cuts. And MSPs on the Criminal Justice Committee were warned that these cuts would impact incident response times. Does the Cabinet Secretary accept that if further police stations were to close, response times would inevitably get worse?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, no, I do not accept that. I think there is a very overly, if the member doesn't mind me saying so, an overly simplistic correlation made here between police stations, static police stations, and police response time. However, I would acknowledge that the location of police stations is important, particularly with respect to some rural areas. But as a member, I am sure, knows there are a number of ways to report a crime that does not always necessitate turning up in person to a police station, and in fact how people report crimes has of course changed greatly over the preceding decades. And in terms of response times, Police Scotland will of course continue to prioritise those emergency incidents and will update and has updated its call handling system also. And in terms of police numbers were recently reported last week with our quarterly statistical update.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you. We need to move on to the supplementaries. I've received a request from three members and I intend to take all three of the supplementary requests. First, supplementary, Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary advise what would be the resources taken from frontline police services if the Chief Constable had decided not to proceed with the closure of police stations he has deemed surplus to optimum operational requirements?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, I should say the Chief Constable is a she. I'm sure Mr Gibson won't mind me pointing that out to him. But in terms of the substance of his question, through the modernisation of the estate and disposing of buildings that are no longer fit for purpose, Police Scotland has secured receipts of around £31 million, which has been reinvested into the police state and to other police initiatives.
Supplementary, Katie Clark.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline which 30 police stations Police Scotland are considering for closure? Local authorities, who already have to deal with reduced hours and indeed far less police in communities than in previous decades, still don't know the full list of planned closures. Is that something that the Cabinet Secretary would be able to share with us today?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, no, it is not, because it is not a matter for me. That would be entirely inappropriate. It is a matter for the Chief Constable and a matter that I am assured that local commanders are engaged directly with local communities, bearing in mind that as a result of the reform legislation, that local authorities have a very active role in approving local priorities for policing. I am quite sure the member is aware of Police Scotland's very public estate strategy published in 2019, and I'm sure she's also aware that the Scottish Police Authority have a role in scrutinising decisions made by Police Scotland and that they meet in public.
And supplementary, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline some of the success co-location with partners has had in delivering better outcomes for individuals, communities and Police Scotland itself?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I can indeed. I have often quoted in this chamber that a great example of co-location is found in Livingston in my constituency, where seven partners, including Police Scotland, are located in the West Lothian Civic Centre. I, of course, understand that people can be attached to long-standing buildings, but, of course, public services and the nature of policing has changed very much over the past several decades and indeed in this century, with a greater focus on partnership working and, of course, co-location and collaboration supports that.
Question number three, not large. Question number four, Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what consideration it is giving to its wider approach to tackling domestic abuse, including its work to develop Scotland's first national multi-agency domestic homicide review model.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, tackling incidents of domestic abuse has been and continues to be a priority for the Scottish Government. It is a fundamental aspect of our Equally Safe strategy, which has currently been revised in consultation with partners and frontline organisations. The Scottish Government-led task force to develop a multi-agency domestic homicide review model has recently concluded a programme of targeted engagement to seek the views of those with lived experience of domestic abuse, those who have been bereaved due to abuse, and those working within the sector on a range of aspects of the model, and a report will be published next month.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. My party have welcomed the introduction of a new pilot scheme to support victims of domestic abuse to escape abusive situations. Given that nearly a quarter of homelessness presentations among women in Scotland were due to abuse, can I ask the Cabinet Secretary when the scheme will commence in South and North Lanarkshire and how this fund can really make a difference to gender-based inequality?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, on the 17th of October, the Government did indeed announce a £500,000 pilot fund to support women and children leaving an abusive relationship. This is a fund that will be delivered by women's aids groups in the five local authority areas. It will enable women to receive up to £1,000. Again, Ms Mackay articulates the barriers, the financial barriers that can exist to prevent someone leaving an abusive relationship. And the pilot fund is expected to run until the 31st of March next year, and it should provide support to between 450 and 900 women.
Supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary expand on the aims of the Domestic Homicide Review Task Force and provide an update on their continuing work?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the aims of this work is to ensure that the murders of women and children have a visibility. While we know that there has been a reduction in homicide statistics, they are now at a historic low. That, of course, is no cause for celebration, and we have seen a reduction in violence resulting in the deaths of men and young men in particular. But what we do know is that in 2022-23, there were 13 women who lost their life due to homicide, and six out of those 13 women were killed by a partner or an ex-partner. And the purpose, the core purpose of this very important work is that we learn from each tragedy, and we learn how to do more to improve the safety of women and girls. And that, at the end of the day, is what those who are left behind wish us to do, and to quote someone, that in learning the lessons of past tragedies, we remember the dead, but we also fight for the living.
And supplementary, Katie Clark.
As the Cabinet Secretary has said, in 2022-23, nearly half of all female victims of homicide were killed by a partner or ex-partner. The Scottish Centre for Crime and Justice Research say that these cases are often not being dealt with appropriately. Has the Cabinet Secretary looked at their research, and does she agree with what they're saying?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am indeed aware of that research, and it is important that for the sake of those who are left behind and for those who have lost their lives, that we routinely and diligently look at each and every tragedy to see what should be learnt, and I think we're in agreement that that is the very valuable core purpose of this work that has been undertaken, and I will endeavour to keep members informed every step of the way.
Question number five, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with Police Scotland regarding its North East pilot not to investigate crimes if that is deemed a proportionate response by the service.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, let me be clear that Police Scotland will continue to investigate all reports of crime across all parts of Scotland. In the North East, where cases are assessed as having no risk or threat, and where it is clear that there are no proportionate lines of inquiry, callers will be informed that their report has been filed and received a crime reference number. However, should new information emerge, officers will investigate appropriately, and this is how Police Scotland has operated since its establishment. And Police Scotland's operational response is, of course, a matter for the Chief Constable. However, I was updated on this matter by DCC Designate Taylor on the 14th of September.
Liam Kerr.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but as this pilot will likely inform the Government's view of local policing going forward, to slopey shoulder it as an operational matter, does our officers and the victims of crime a disservice? And given anecdotal evidence of victims feeling abandoned, criminals feeling there's a free-for-all and general public disquiet, is the Scottish Government minded to see this pilot go nationwide? And in any event, what are the measurements and outcomes that determine whether it has been a success?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, let me be clear that despite how this pilot, a matter for Police Scotland, has been narrated, all crime reported will, as has always been the case, will be investigated under this pilot. That was the assurance that I received directly from Police Scotland. And Police Scotland ensure that threat, harm, risk, investigation, vulnerability and engagement is all assessed as part of their Thrive model. And if it is clear that there are no leads and there is no risk in terms of threat, harm, vulnerability, the measures as outlined in my original answer will be undertaken. The only difference between what currently happens and what is being trialled in this pilot is a quicker decision in relation to proportionate line of inquiry. And the focus to answer Mr Kerr's question in more direct terms is I can assure him that the focus of this government will remain on keeping our communities safe from harm and ensuring that our police officers, the length and breadth of this country, have the appropriate support to make
appropriate operational decisions. Call supplementary, Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst I appreciate decisions such as the pilot project in the North East for the Chief Constable, can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the Scottish Government continues to support Police Scotland to ensure that local priorities are met and relationships with local communities, which she alluded to a short time ago, are maintained?
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Focus on the pilot, please.
Presiding Officer, communities will remain at the heart of policing and the Scottish Government has highlighted the importance of community relationships within the updated strategic police priorities published earlier this year and the Police and Fire Reform Act now ensures that councils have to approve policing plans and the key priorities for their area and of course they work alongside Police Scotland's local commanders.
Question number six has been withdrawn. Question number seven, Michelle Thompson.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether the plans for legal services regulation reform will meet the original objectives of the Roberton Review regarding consumer complaints.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill is designed to deliver the objectives of the Roberton Review to provide a modern regulatory framework that will promote competition, innovation alongside the public and the consumer interest in an efficient, independent legal sector. The Bill seeks to balance and deliver the key priorities of all stakeholders by improving the transparency and accountability of legal services regulation and the legal complaint system, and increasing the transparency and accountability of legal regulation. The Bill embeds consumer principles into the regulatory framework and introduces a more flexible and responsive approach to complaints while expanding independent oversight of complaint handling.
Michelle Thompson.
I thank the Minister for that response, but it's not just the Roberton Review that concluded the optimum model for regulatory model must be independent of regulatory bodies. The CMA, Consumer Scotland, leading lawyers such as Brian Inkster and others also hold this view and have made that clear in evidence. There is a clear and fundamental conflict of interest in having consumer complaints processed by bodies that exist to protect the interests of their profession. Now, the better regulation principles would suggest that the model that has been proposed, although with some extra provisions, simply cannot square this conflict of interest off. The proposed new processes still have the same complexities and are extraordinarily difficult to navigate as a consumer. Will the Minister look again at how we best service consumer complaints about lawyers in line with the better regulation recommendations
set out in the
Roberton Review? Thank you, Ms.
Thompson. I think the Minister's probably got the gist.
Thank
Minister.
You, Presiding Officer. The Law Society will be required to exercise regulatory functions, including complaint handling, independently of its other functions, and it will be required to delegate regulatory functions of an independent regulatory committee comprised of a minimum of 50% lay members and a lay chair. The Scottish Legal Complaints Commission will retain oversight of complaint handling and continue to have a role in monitoring trends in legal complaints. In addition, the Commission will have a role in setting minimum standards as how legal practitioners and legal regulators handle complaints, providing independent oversight. I have been watching the evidence sessions very closely of the DPLR and the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee, and I am happy to discuss further with the member.
And supplementary, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. One of my constituents has recently faced difficulties with the complex appeals process in the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. That's why I welcome the review's recommendation that a simple process of appeals be developed. Why then is the Scottish Government removing the ability to appeal decisions altogether and turning their backs on complainers?
Minister.
Thank you. We are in the process of stage one of the regulation of legal services, and I will listen to the views of the committee.
And supplementary, Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. McClure Solicitors, founded in Gnaenga in 1853, has tens of thousands of clients across Britain specialising in wills and trusts, but it went into liquidation recently and the Law Society of Scotland are monitoring it. Another firm, Jones & White, took on the files, but they are reportedly charging those victims of McClure's collapse £300 plus VAT. Is the Scottish Government reading about this case and learning any lessons? And can the Cabinet Secretary assure me she's having discussions with the legal profession to ensure that ordinary Scots are protected from situations like this?
Minister.
Thank you. I can't comment as Minister on specific ongoing legal situations. But I would encourage anybody that does have a complaint to go to the Law Society and make the official complaint. That we are learning lessons in the stage two of the DPLR yesterday. I did highlight to the committee an amendment which was would help a situation like McClure's not happening again. And there will also be legislation moving for the regulation of legal services moving forward to prevent this happening again.
And question number eight, Kate Forbes.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its commitment to develop a model for Scotland to challenge men's demand for prostitution.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you. The Scottish Government continues to develop a framework which effectively tackles and challenges men's demand for prostitution and to support those with experience of it. The framework will be published in the new year and our focus will be to implement it with support from a new stakeholder group. The principles for the framework were published last year and will embed equality, human rights and safety at the heart of the new framework. These principles have also been adopted across Scottish Government to inform relevant policy and practice in turning supporting Scotland's collective approach into tackling commercial sexual exploitation.
K. Kate Forbes.
Later this month, we will note 16 days of activism against gender-based violence. The Scottish Government has accepted that prostitution is violence against women. Can the Minister advise when the Scottish Government will bring forward legislation to criminalise men who exploit women in this way?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Prostitution cannot be considered in isolation, and there are many factors which must be considered within this work, of which criminal law is only one aspect. And it should be remembered that law already prohibits many activities associated with prostitution, including trading in prostitution of others, the running of a brothel, procuring for the purposes of prostitution, as well as publicly soliciting or loitering for the purpose of purchasing sex. That is why we are focusing on the development and the delivery of the framework to enable women to sustainably exit from prostitution, which will inform any future legislative considerations.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on Justice and Home Affairs, and there will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business to allow those who wish to change position to do so. Thank you.